Joining us to talk about this and much, much more is Mini Time. When I say Mini, I think we're at 11 or 12 New York Times bestselling author, Ann Coulter. Ann, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm so happy to be here.
Always
on this
fantastic.
Exciting morning. As you may or may not know, I've been all over this Epstein case since 2005. It was only a local story in Palm Beach. The chief of police, this all originated when some 14-year-old girl in West Palm Beach somehow fell into the cop's hands. I guess it was her mother went and reported it to the police, saying there was a billionaire in Palm Beach who was paying her daughter to come to his mansion and have sex.
Oh my God.
So the Palm Beach police staged this top secret, absolutely incredible, at least 6-month investigation. They got 17 of the child victims to sign affidavits, some of the procurers. They were watching Epstein's house, collecting his garbage for 6 months. They got affidavits from the houseman saying things like, you know, after the 14-year-old girls would be there when they'd come. So all of this, after this really spectacular investigation, the Palm Beach police are very good, surprisingly, for a small town. But there's a lot of money in that town. They take it to the prosecutors are called state attorneys in Florida, Barry Krischer, who was the one, just, you know, footnote, spent 3 years tormenting Rush Limbaugh over the back pain medication, which, okay, it's a violation, but to be getting all that national publicity over it, and there were some outrageous things done in that regard. Anyway, Barry Krischer, and I mention this particularly to counterbalance the political angle that's being taken today.
Oh, yeah,
but I was
because
writing about it at the time.
Some of the men, they're both sides, both Republicans and Democrats,
yes,
very prominent
yes.
men. They're all pigs and pedophiles, if true.
Well, there was one lonely voice in the woods pointing that out long ago, Jillian.
Mm-hmm. I believe it.
So Barry Krischer, big Democratic prosecutor, gets all this information and sentences Epstein to probation. Probation, he only charges him with one attempt of attempting to solicit prostitution, thus labeling the 14-year-old girls prostitutes. The chief of police, Michael Ryder, goes mental. He starts, you know, talking to the press, and he says, I'm going to take this to the FBI. Well, okay, note here, all of the crimes that they had found, based on the mother in West Palm Beach, all of the crimes are state crimes. I mean, people always think, you know, the FBI can go after anything.
Right.
At this point, nobody knew about the island. There was no evidence on the New York offenses. These are state crimes. So the FBI hands it over to Alex Acosta, who is now Trump's labor secretary, as you will hear 10 times a day. Acosta could have done a better job, and his prosecutors could have done a better job. But what they ended up doing, and I think this should be looked at, don't get me wrong, they came under enormous pressure from, as you say, and I was pointing out when Hannity was trying to turn this into an exclusively Democratic scandal, among Epstein's dream team of attorneys was both Alan Dershowitz and Ken Starr. When you have that kind of money, you can hire a whole dream team. And they're threatening, they're calling up the prosecutors, looking into their personal lives. Acosta's office ends up getting Epstein. There's a plea bargain. He agrees to plead guilty to state charges because, again, that's all they have at that point. State charges, and he'll be sentenced to, I don't know, whatever it was. It was supposed to be, you know, 2 years or something. All because they're state charges, that gets sent to whom? Back to the Democratic state government of West Palm Beach. It is the county officials and, again, Barry Krischer who decide how that 2-year term is going to be spent. He ended up, as I'm sure you've heard, he ended up spending 16 months, just a certain number of hours per day in the county jail in his own private wing with his own private bodyguards. He could spend, I believe it was 12 hours a day back on his mansion on Palm Beach. And part of the settlement agreement, this is the crucial part, the prosecutors agreed, took a non-prosecution agreement against the lawyers, all of Epstein's friends, procurers, everyone else involved, including Alan Dershowitz and other lawyers involved.
Mm.
So Paul Cassell, brilliant lawyer, comes along. He happens to be, and this is why Hannity used to describe this pretty much exclusively as a Democratic scandal. No, it is not. But Paul Cassell is a big crime victims rights advocate, and I believe helped write the law. It's a federal law. It's only a federal law. Where with crime victims saying, look, we want the same rights as criminals. We want to know after we've been victimized what the prosecutors are doing. So the fact that Acosta's office, the U.S. Attorney's Office for Southern District of Florida, the fact that they struck this somewhat lenient, not as horribly lenient as the state charges.
Quietly,
he at least
though.
Got some jail time,
yeah.
But without keeping the victims informed.
They didn't know until Epstein was out of prison. That was over a year. They did not know. It's outrageous.
So under the law, this Crime Victims' Rights Act, that allowed Paul Cassell, and he had a local attorney helping, to go in, breach the agreement, and say, we want this opened, we want this thrown out, because the crime victims were not notified, they were not allowed to confront, all of the rights that came with it. No idea whatsoever. In their pleadings, that's when, particularly Virginia Roberts, that was her name at the time, is now Virginia Roberts, Jeffra, she's living in Australia, and married. She starts naming people like Prince Andrew, Alan Dershowitz, and Bill Clinton as some of the molesters. But again, nobody was reporting this. In fact, when the story first broke, I called it in to Bill O'Reilly, bless his little soul. He led the story. This is back in
he was dealing with his own sex scandals.
this is January 2006, and he did a story on the Barry Krischer prosecution. It was a great story. I kept asking him whenever I'd see him, hey, you said you were going to keep following up on that story. Can you bring it up again? But he was the only one to mention it. I have searched the Nexus archives. MSNBC and CNN did not mention it for a decade. So now that it's going through the courts, thanks to Paul Cassell opening up the federal deal, more and more and more is coming out. The Lolita Island, the other men involved, the woman involved.
Yeah, that Maxwell woman.
And the great news is, because it is a different district, now they're getting into much more of the federal crimes and also the Manhattan-based crimes, which allows the U.S. Attorney's Office in Manhattan to go after Jeffrey Epstein on these crimes. That's why he was arrested this morning.
Can you stick with us for one more segment? Because it's being reported that one of the men involved that's cooperating with the FBI is an A-level Hollywood star. You know more about this case than anyone. I want to pick your brain about who else you think could be involved.
And I want to, get what Ann thinks it will be the end for Jeffrey Epstein if all this goes through, like what he gets sentencing wise. So please stick around, Ann. Thank you.
Yes.
Fascinating stuff. Yeah. You can read her online at AnnCoulter.com. Of course, follow her on Twitter at AnnCoulter. But first, we're going to take a look at the roads. It's 9:51 on Talk Radio 790 KABC. Jillian Barbary, John Phillips here until 10. We're joined by Ann Coulter, who you can follow on Twitter at Ann Coulter. Ann, we've seen a lot of speculation as to who else is going to be named in this Jeffrey Epstein case. Lots of Hollywood stars, politicians, billionaires, royalty. Are there any names, do you think, that are going to surprise us?
I think I've been reading that, what's it called, Crazy Days, Crazy Nights, and they're often very good, all the blind items. I'm more dubious of the Hollywood types than I am of international, powerful people. I think the most interesting two things about this case are, number one, where does Jeffrey Epstein get his money? My theory, but my theory doesn't account for it all. We know it's not because he's investing money. He was, a high school math teacher. This guy Wexner grabs him. Oh, you're a genius. And suddenly, the amount of real estate and private planes this guy has, it is billions of dollars. You're not privately investing anything without ever, moving the market. That is clearly untrue. My theory was that he was the concierge of this underage sex club, so to speak, and some wealthy men paid for this. But, you know, this is kind of a niche sexual fetish, underage boys and
pedophilia.
Girls. I mean, how many billionaires do we have here? Which makes me, and let me throw the other second thing that I think is very interesting about this case. Epstein, according to both the girls' accounts, he wanted them to have sex with powerful men, come back to him and report on it, describe what they wanted, what their fetishes were, and he had cameras throughout the house. So this is obviously for blackmailing purposes. It just seems to me there is a bigger, something much bigger is behind this, perhaps a state sponsor, powerful enough people. For, as the evidence I described for the original state charge, forget the, you know, Democrat, Republicans, whatever. It just seems to me there's something, a very powerful force behind what's going on here. And I am still nervous about this not coming to a conclusion. Somehow, this
really?
Getting compromised.
Even with all of this, you think that...
Well, only because, you know, I've been following this for 15 years now, and it's just unbelievable how it gets swept under. The advantage...
Yeah,
sorry, go ahead.
It's never been as big as this, though. I mean, this is it. They've you know, I mean, I know that you had that sweetheart deal before, but wow, this is not going under the rug again. The genie's out of the bottle, it seems.
I hope right, and the irony is that the reason it may not go under the rug, but I'm still not discounting that possibility. There's powerful money behind this guy. I don't know where it's coming from. I think it's bigger than Hollywood. The reason I tend to discount the Hollywood side is, you know, the girls would have recognized at least anyone who's on camera. Yeah. And also, I kind of feel like Hollywood has its own you know, sex rings. And
Harvey
this
Weinstein.
Was more for financiers and international types who didn't have access to that. But the ironic thing is, even though it isn't true, I really don't want to shoot it down, the fact that there is this tertiary 6 degrees of separation connection to Donald Trump seems to be one of the things that is totally keeping this in the news.
Yeah.
And okay, if that works, fine.
Well, he did call him a very fine guy, and he did like girls on the younger side. Donald Trump did, quote, say that.
That was in 2002. In 2005, the great Vanity Fair investigative reporter Vicki Ward did a major profile on Epstein. She described sitting in a living room of some young girl with her crying on Vicki Ward's lap, saying, talking about the abuse.
Oh, my God.
Jeffrey Epstein, this is 3 years after that quote from Trump.
Horrible.
Jeffrey Epstein calls Graydon Carter. He cuts that from the article.
Oh, my God.
Well, there's a whole Twitter feed right now from this woman, from the author
Herald.
Of the Vanity Fair piece, who talks about Graydon Carter cutting lots of aspects of the young girls out of that story. And we're out
Horrible.
Of time. We got to run. We'll have you back soon. Fascinating stuff.
It really is.
I'm assuming the column's going to be about this week.
I guess so.
Okay.
Yeah, it should be. You've been following it. You're very schooled on this.
AnnCoulter.com is the website. Ann, you're the best.
Thank you, Ann.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
It's 9:55. This is Talk Radio 790 KABC.